This show is part of the RetroZap.com podcast network.
This is Podcast Stardust.
This station is now the ultimate power in the universe.
With Dennis Keithley and Jay Krebs.
Your behavior is continually unexpected.
The galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion.
Now witness the firepower of this fully armed and operational battle station.
Hello, I'm Dennis Keithley.
And I'm Jay Krebs.
And welcome to another fully armed and operational edition of Podcast Stardust. This is the galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion. Before we get on with this week's review of The Clone Wars, Jay, where can we be found around the internet?
We can be found on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust. And we can be reached by email at podcaststardust@retrozap.com.
So this week we are talking about episode 2 of season 7 of The Clone Wars, and this one is titled A Distant Echo. So with that, we are going to get into a full spoiler discussion, starting with our episode summary. And Jay, if you would, give that summary to us.
I would love to. After raiding the Separatist Cyber Center, Rex, Anakin, and the Bad Batch prepare to raid the Separatist facility on Skako Minor to determine whether Echo is alive or if the Separatists were simply using an advanced algorithm. Before they depart, Rex covers for Anakin while he makes a clandestine call to his secret wife, Padme Amidala. However, Obi-Wan arrives looking for Anakin, and despite Rex's attempt to cover, it is apparent that Obi-Wan knows a little more about Anakin and Padme's relationship. On Skako Minor, Anakin and the clones are confronted by the Poltecs. They want nothing to do with the war, but after a confrontation with Anakin and the clones, they agree to guide them to the Separatist base. Once at the base, the stealth mission fails as the Bad Batch infiltrates with guns blazing. Eventually, they find a stasis chamber, and Rex and Tech discover that Echo was in fact alive, although he is a cyborg now and had been held in stasis by the Separatists.
And there you have it. So overall, what did you think about this one?
Oh my gosh. I have watched this 5 times already.
Wow,
since it
okay.
has come out. Yeah, this has got to be among, and of course, we're talking about all of the Clone Wars here, one of my favorite episodes ever.
Really? Okay.
Yes.
That says volumes.
It does, because it doesn't even have Ahsoka in it. So
yeah.
So right there says a lot. Or Darth Maul. And the reason I loved it so much is just because we're starting to get these Revenge of the Sith kind of feels with, we know, of course, where this is going to end up, but just the whole scene with Anakin and Padme and then what ensues after that. Oh my gosh. And I can't wait to talk about that more in depth. But just the idea of Rex being so incredibly loyal. And of course, we've seen that throughout. And we see it in Rebels. And we know it. And we know how amazing Rex is. But I don't know what about this episode just made me love Rex like a million times more.
Yeah, there was some great stuff about Anakin and Padme and Rex and in this episode. And I'm not surprised to hear that you loved it. I was a little surprised that you claimed it's one of your favorite of the entire series, which is mm-hmm. amazing. It's a good episode. I really liked it. I don't think quite as much as you did, but that still doesn't make it a bad episode. But let's kind of get into some of these moments. You know, so the episode starts off with them preparing to go get Echo, because Rex firmly believes that Echo is alive. And even though he's saying things like it's probably a long shot that he is, you get the feeling throughout this episode that he believes in his heart that Echo is alive. Mm-hmm. And, you know, he's talking to Anakin, and Anakin's saying something to the fact that they're going to need to get approval from the Jedi Council, but he's pretty sure that they'll get it. And so, you know, immediately Rex is like, well, then what are we waiting for? Let's go. And Anakin's like, not so fast. We have that thing we have to do. And Rex isn't getting the hint that he wants to go back to the barracks and have Rex just kind of cover for him while he contacts Padme. Now, some interesting things came out here, and I had an opportunity to get into the episode guide for this one on StarWars.com, and there was a, I think they call it the Clone Wars download, where it this one featured a lot of Dave Filoni talking about some of the backstory to this one. I don't know if you had a chance to see that yet or not.
No.
But, you know, you brought up the conversation, you know, this point that we had some great Anakin and Padme interaction. This was not originally planned for this episode. This was something they added because, as you recall, this Bad Batch arc was shown in its animatic form back in 2015 at Celebration Anaheim. And this scene was not there, but when they plotted out these final 12 episodes for season 7, Padme didn't appear anywhere in them. Mm-hmm. So they added this scene so that they could get Padme back into the final season. Now, that's not to say that they didn't add her anywhere else, but Dave specifically mentioned that she was added for this. And so there's that. But was it just me, or was Anakin completely oblivious to the fact that his wife was noticeably pregnant while he was talking to her? And maybe it's just because the angle he was looking at her from the hologram, where we got to see them from the side.
Yes. Well, you know, I know when we had first talked about the trailer and we said, you know, it's got to be right around, you know, after he gets back and he knows about all this, or, you know, how can he not know this? But one thing that I did notice is that when he turns on the hologram, he stands up with his eyes closed, and when he opens his eyes, he's staring directly into hers.
Mm-hmm.
And he never loses that connection, except for when Rex starts banging on the door and he kind of like looks back and then looks right back at her. Like, he never breaks that eye contact. He is just completely mesmerized by her face. So that's about the only thing that I can imagine that would be an answer for that. And I know that they're clear across the galaxy from one another, but with the connection that they had, and we saw it in Revenge of the Sith, where they could feel each other's presence even across Coruscant, that should he have been able to sense another presence, you know, with her? But again, it was over hologram, so it's kind of reaching. But I just kind of thought maybe he would have felt another Force presence, especially with her carrying twins.
Possibly, but, you know, even in Revenge of the Sith, when he finally gets to catch up with her after they rescue the Chancellor, he is stunned by the news that she's
True.
Pregnant. And she's standing right in front of him. I mean, they just embrace, as mm-hmm. a matter of fact. You know,
That's
the thing
true.
Is, during this scene, her hands are always on her belly.
Mm-hmm.
And she's always, you know, there's an image I put in our notes of her with one hand right on her belly. I mean, on her pregnancy bump. So it's mm-hmm. it was just very consumed by your thoughts, Anakin, because that seemed a bit obvious to me. Now, so they're having this conversation, and Padme goes on to kind of counsel Anakin about what's going on with Rex, because Anakin is clearly concerned about Rex and the almost obsession Rex has with going to rescue Echo. And then Padme points out that, you know, well, look, you know, you've been with him for a long time, and when you go charging off into your crazy schemes, where's Rex? And then Anakin says, well, he's always right by my side. So, you know, she's kind of reminding him that he needs to return that favor and be there for Rex and, you know, help him get through all this.
Mm-hmm.
But this conversation, as you were alluding to earlier, gets interrupted because, you know, Rex has had a great little bit of imagery out there. He's standing outside the barracks, just kind of waving to other clones as they walk by, just doing that nonchalant thing that completely makes you look like you're up to something, no matter how much you try. And Obi-Wan comes walking up to the barracks, and Rex says, oh, great. And Obi-Wan is all eager-eyed, and he comes up and he's looking for Anakin. And so Rex is doing his best to forestall Obi-Wan and giving out some of the lamest excuses ever as to why he can't let him into the barracks or what Anakin might be up to. This ultimately ends with, you know, him banging on the barracks door before, you know, Obi-Wan gets up there. It kind of breaks up the conversation. And then Anakin comes out, and Obi-Wan is just perplexed because he's not really being let in on the secret that Anakin was talking to Padme, but he knows Anakin was talking to Padme. And at the end of the conversation, as Anakin is walking off, you know, he says, did you at least say hello to Padme for me?
Mm-hmm.
So he was very, you know, it was no secret that to him that Obi-Wan, you know, or I'm sorry, that Anakin was in there talking to Padme. Now, Dave had some interesting things to say about that, but before we get into that, what was your take on what Obi-Wan knew?
Well, obviously, like you said, he knew what was going on. And I think that he was probably pushed almost in his frustration to blurt that out, because Anakin was just blowing him off so badly, thinking he had the upper hand over him, you know, thinking that he had one pulled over his, the wool pulled over his eyes kind of a thing. Because, you know, Anakin always ribbed Obi-Wan, too, about his and Satine's relationship. At one time, you know, and teased him about his girlfriend, and she's not my girlfriend, you know, and those types of things. So, you know, I think that he, you know, man to man, he definitely was sensing that. And even back to the Attack of the Clones movie, when Anakin was all ruffled about her, and, you know, and he would tease her, him about how, oh, I can sense everything going on in there. And he said, maybe you're not so attuned, my young Padawan. And he said, oh, and you are. So he was, he's always been kind of ribbing him and getting that little jealousy, you know, kind of thing going. So I didn't not expect it, I guess. But then again, it kind of did come out of left field that he just blurted that right out. But I do want to back up just a little bit to a couple of things here as far as the way that Anakin feels about Rex. So, of course, he's his commander. He's been right by his side, as Padme pointed out. He's been there through thick and thin. But I just feel like this is another example of Anakin's compassion and his attachment. And this is what the Jedi were trying to warn against, was this attachment. But yet, you know, here's this clone that is a clone and could be just like any other clone. But you know that Anakin has a very high respect for him. He sees him as a friend, not just as a coworker, so to speak. And there's just a much, much more deep type of relationship. There's a trust there. Just like when he looks at Rex and says, we have to do that thing. He's like, well, what, we don't have time. No, yes, yes, we do. And Anakin's trying to be all like Mr. Authoritative, but yet, come on, you're in on this with me, buddy. Let's go do this. Mm-hmm. So, you know, there's just so much to that scene that I just love it. I really do.
Yeah. Well, when I was asking you about the, you know, what it was that Obi-Wan knew, this has sparked a lot of discussion online about, mm-hmm. you know, does Obi-Wan know that they're married? Does he know that they're in a relationship? And Dave went out of his way on that Clone Wars download to say that, you know, he believes, and because he's not speaking definitively, because, you know, remember, this is a story that George Lucas created, and so he can only contribute so much definitively to this. But he said that he believes that Obi-Wan knows that Anakin is still in love with Padme based on their past relationships, but he doesn't believe that Anakin would have gone so far as to marry her. And for the same things that you were just pointing out, that, you know, he had a love for Satine in his past, you know, he kind of understands how those things work. And I kind of got the feeling that perhaps Obi-Wan was a little hurt by all this, because, you know, as he tells Anakin in Revenge of the Sith, you know, I raised you since you were a little boy, and, you know, you've grown into be a much more man than I am. And, you know, they were, and then, you know, later at the Revenge of the Sith, we were like brothers, but Obi-Wan's not being brought in on this secret, you know, that, you know, but Rex is. So I kind of feel like that, you know, that's a feeling that a Jedi is probably not supposed to have, with the jealousy and that type of a thing. But Obi-Wan, over the years, you know, Anakin went from being a burden that Qui-Gon imposed on him to, you know, to a brother, and to be kind of left out of that. I kind of feel like Obi-Wan perhaps was a little bit hurt by the exclusion there. But yeah, I do agree with you. This, you know, this episode, you know, from here on out, because this is, you know, this is where we say goodbye to Obi-Wan, it really does focus a lot in between the action scenes on Anakin and Rex's relationship. You know, one other thing I wanted to bring up real quick, because we were talking about Padme, is that in the original animatic version of this episode, when they are about to depart, you know, we didn't have the scene with Padme and Anakin, but Padme appeared in this episode as artwork on the side of the Bad Batch's ship. And it was kind of in that style that you would see on bombers in World War II, where they'd have a woman paint on the side of the ship. And that got removed. And it was funny, because if you go back and you watch the animatic, you know, Anakin notices right away and kind of points it out. And the Bad Batch is like, you know, yeah, that's our girl. And, you know, Wrecker says something along the lines of, you know, she can negotiate with me anytime. Right. And then as they're getting on the ship, Anakin leans over to Rex and says, that is not staying up there. So,
right.
So interesting little scene there that they removed. So the episode then moves on to their passage to Skako Minor, and Rucker is working out by lifting a gonk droid one-handed while chewing on a drumstick with the other one. And there's some tension between Rex and some of the members of the Bad Batch. You know, Crosshairs begins ribbing that he gives him that he's just a reg. And Crosshair, last time we talked about Clone Wars, I kind of talked about these guys as kind of being the clone X-Men. Mm-hmm. And it almost comes out that way, that they know that there's something different than the rest of their clones, and it is because of mutation in their genetics. And so they may or may not be accepted by the rest of the clones, but they kind of are, to a degree, the protector of the regs, as the Bad Batch calls them, even though they resent them sometime. And that very much comes out in this episode, that, you know, Rex is a reg, and, you know, Rex must abandon Echo at the Citadel. But, you know, hey, I do the same too, because he's just another reg. So mm-hmm. It's an interesting dynamic that I got going on here. And the tension is kind of constantly being diffused by either Hunter or Anakin throughout this episode. It's kind of weird thinking of Anakin as kind of the peacemaker.
Right, right. But you know what? He really is throughout his life as a Jedi, for the most part. I mean, he's not a bad negotiator when it comes right down to it, when it's something that he believes in as far as a personal relationship, is where I see it more often than not.
Right. But he's a bit of a hothead.
He is. Oh, yeah. So definitely.
So they get to Skako Minor, and they're immediately assaulted by a flying reptile with one of these Poltecs on them. And they have a interesting little action scene. One of the lizards grabs Anakin and takes off with him, causing Anakin to drop his lightsaber. And then, in another great example of the teamwork that the Bad Batch has, Tech calculates the trajectory to this flying lizard, and then Crosshair changes out the barrel of his rifle to a grappling device, and then launches a grapple that wraps around some part of this lizard, and then Hunter grabs it and goes flying off after Anakin in pursuit. They get to the Poltec village, and then the rest of the Bad Batch and Rex catches up to him, and they infiltrate the village. They don't kill anybody, and as you said in the summary, they had this discussion where they are going to get some assistance from the Poltecs to find the Separatist base. This episode is really the three parts. It's the part that had Anakin and Padme, and then Obi-Wan's reaction was part one. Part two was this interaction with the Poltecs, and then part three is the infiltration of the base. But overall, what did you think of this middle section of the episode?
Well, I thought that the animation was amazing right here, because as soon as that flying lizard grabs Anakin, you see the look of almost like shock on his face, which I feel like, yes, the Clone Wars has done amazing things all throughout its history with animation, but I just feel like everything is so much more smooth so far in this these two episodes that we've seen. And when Rex was shooting at the lizard, I was watching the episode one of the five times with Colby Wan, and he said, wow, what if Rex would have actually hit Anakin? Then there would not have been any Darth Vader at all.
Right.
And I'm like, yeah, you're absolutely right. And I think Rex did that mostly, you know, obviously to protect Anakin, but almost out of desperation too, in some ways, that there goes Anakin. But what I really appreciated about this scene was when Tech was communicating with the Poltecs, and he had the Orabesh on the one side of his little visor thing, and then he had the Poltec language on the other side, which was a completely different style of alphabet. Mm-hmm. And then he was able to communicate with them by, you know, emulating their vocabulary. And I just thought that was really, really cool.
Yeah, it was admirable, considering the fact that the way the Poltecs spoke had some reverberation and some echo in it.
Yes.
And it was very, very cool, but I would lose my mind in about 5 minutes talking to those guys, because it's just when the first time I saw this episode, and I haven't seen it five times, I've seen it twice. I kept trying to listen in. I turned it up as like, is it just that it's echoing and I'm not understanding this? But no, it was a completely alien language. It was just so garbled there that I was like, well, prop to Text that, you know, he can translate all this and then actually speak it back to them. But so that was a neat scene. And again, it's just they give all the members of the Bad Batch plenty of opportunities to demonstrate their skills and what makes them unique. And this was a great scene for Tech in this episode. So they resolve their differences with the Poltecs, and then they head off to the Separatist base. But before they get there, Admiral Trench contacts Wat Tambor and basically tells him, hey, be on the lookout. Some clones are headed that way. They've figured out that this is the source of the algorithm. Mm-hmm. And so it was cool to see Wat Tambor again. And I don't know if it was just this planet, but he didn't have nearly difficulty speaking or keeping his voice modulated like he does everywhere else that we've seen him.
Okay, thank you. Because I noticed that too. And I didn't know if maybe it was something within the atmosphere or, you know, or what was going on, or maybe just the fact that he was home and there was maybe, you know, different radiative frequencies in the air even. Who knows?
Right, right. And what is it with the Techno Union? Because, you know, they're there on this planet and they're almost, not so much, but the Techno Union and the Trade Federation, stuff like this, they keep claiming weird relationships with the Republic. Like they aren't really part of the Separatists. Mm-hmm. There's some sort of a neutral ground here, but, you know, they clearly are conspiring with the Separatists here. I mean, because they get a call from Admiral Trench.
Right.
So I don't know. That's a question that I'm going to need to get answered someday. But anyway, so they get to the base and finally Rex has a blowout with the Bad Batch and he's goaded into it by Crosshair. So it's not entirely his fault. But again, Crosshair gets into the whole thing about abandoning Echo back there on the Citadel, and Rex protests that he did what he had to do, that, you know, they were on this mission and Echo was believed dead, and so he had to finish the mission. Mm-hmm. And then again, you know, Rex ends up taking a swipe at Crosshair, and then Wrecker says, you know, hey, pick on someone who's bigger than you, or that's not your size. And then finally Anakin rushes in and breaks it off, and he sends the Bad Batch off, and then he speaks to Rex on his own and counsels him that, you know, you have to be prepared that Echo may not be alive. And then again, something you were talking about earlier, this is when Rex kind of gets into some of his philosophy about what's been going on with the Clone Wars, where he's lost a lot of brothers over the years, and he's not really given it a lot of attention or given it, you know, or paid mind to it. But when he heard Echo's voice, that kind of changed everything. Because, you know, we saw in the last episode when he was looking at that picture of him and Cody and Fives and Echo, and now the weight of all the brothers he's lost is starting to, it's starting to impact him. It's starting to have a real effect.
And here's my thought too with that as well, is that there's got to be, you know, how could he possibly know that that was Echo? Because if they're all quote unquote regs, they all have pretty much the same voice because they're all clones.
Well, Echo did use his number, CT1409, I think, or 7, in the signal.
Right, but he was so emphatic about that was his voice. Not even, you know, the fact that he knew that the number was there and that was, you know, it was just, it wouldn't have mattered. You know what I mean?
Okay.
Like, knowing the number wouldn't have mattered.
Sure. The way I looked at it was like this. When you hear other ethnicities speaking a foreign language, I find it frequently difficult to tell the voices apart. But they clearly know different voices from each other. I suspect, while we think all the clones sound exactly right, they can actually tell their voices apart. And that even as close, as similar as they look, they can look at one of them and say that, you know, that's Cody. Even though the guy right next to him probably looks almost identical, they see enough of a difference there to distinguish them. And I'm with you that, you know, how would they know? But I got to think that the clones are so similar that they are attuned even to the most minor differences between them. And that's how he was able to tell.
I 100% love and respect that answer. Can I just say?
Thank you.
That was awesome. Seriously.
Okay. Well, so they get to the base and the Bad Batch immediately throws the whole stealth mission out the window because
a little bit
they go in blazing and we get some new battle droids here. What'd you think of them?
Weird. Like, what? They almost remind me of praying mantises. That's the first thing that came to my mind.
They had the reverse hinged legs, which reminded me of the Geonosians themselves. They look kind of like the Geonosians to begin with, but then they had these different legs, and then they kind of had the arms that came over the top that I thought, well, those supposed to reflect a modification of the wings that some of the Geonosians had, because they kind of seemed to walk and move around a bit more like the Geonosians did than the traditional B1 battle droids.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and all I can think is that it's got to be something that is, you know, basically that particular planet needs to have that particular model of droid, you know what I mean, for whatever reason.
Yeah, so but they don't seem to be any more effective in battle, because Bad Batch just plows through them. They eventually get to this room where Echo signals coming from. Now, that's something we haven't addressed, and Tech finally figures this out, because Echo's signal keeps coming and going, and then Tech finally puts things together that he's only picking up what they've been calling Echo's signal when Echo's been transmitting information. And so at various times when they've kind of lost their triangulation as to where they need to go, it's because Echo wasn't transmitting anything, but then when he started talking again, he'd pick up the signal and they'd be able to hone in a little bit. So they get to this room, and beyond this door is whatever it is that they're going to find, whether it's the algorithm or Echo or whatever. Before they can access it, Wat Tambor shows up on the view screen, which is the same style that we got in The Phantom Menace when Padme was talking to Nuke Gunray and the rest of the Trade Federation. That was kind of a cool inclusion, because I'm not sure that we've really had an opportunity to see that in too many places in Star Wars outside the Phantom Menace.
Right. And I mean, we do get that also on Snoke's ship too, when Rey is looking out that little viewport thing. Isn't that basically the same kind of thing?
I just always interpreted that as a magnification of looking out that window, but it could be.
Oh, okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, mm-hmm. But I don't know. But you get the same sound effect, that hum as it starts up, and then the image kind of blurs in a little bit. And this was all taken from Flash Gordon. It was an homage to effect from that movie. And
that
or
movie.
Show. Right. And so now they brought it back again for this episode, which is really cool. And they mentioned that they've come for Echo, and Wat Tambor says, you know, no, your friend is dead, but his mind is ours. So he acknowledges that they have Echo back there. And they defeat another wave of battle droids, and then Tech and Rex get in there. And this scene was creepy. I kind of got a little wigged out a little bit the first time I saw this, but there is a stasis chamber. They open it up, and then Echo comes falling face first out of it, but he's held up by the cables he's attached to. His skin is waxy and gray, and he's got a cybernetic arm and leg. So he's a cyborg at this point. And when he kind of comes to, his eyes are vibrating back and forth like he's been in REM sleep or something, like he's still processing some information. And when he's with it enough to speak, he's reliving his last moments on the Citadel about having to get to the shuttle. And, you know, then he kind of has a reaction to the explosion that we all believed kill him. So I was just like, wow, what did you think about all that?
Yes, creepy is an understatement for sure. I was not expecting that visualization right there. And this just goes back to what I love about the Clone Wars in general, though, is that it does go to a darker place than we see in any of the other animated shows. And it does it so well and with such effect. But yeah, I mean, exactly what you said, when he came kind of tumbling out at him, and just even I call it the camera angle, you know, as you're looking up at him, it's very Frankensteinish in a way, but you see he's just so emaciated, and like you said, he's got this waxy skin. It almost even looked like he's got ice crystals on him as well, because you know that he's probably being held, you know, at a much lower temperature, almost to preserve him in a way, to preserve his flesh. But it was great to hear him finally come through, and he recognized Rex then at that point, when he's like, Echo, we're here to take you home, you know, and he's like, Rex, you came back for me. Oh my gosh. I started crying right there. Not gonna lie.
Yeah. Cause you know, when he pops out, Rex is like, oh my, what did they do to you?
Yeah.
And he's like, you know, just, you know, it's going to be okay, Echo, you know, we're taking you home, soldier. And you know, it's, and I felt for Rex in all that too, because you know, he was so certain that Echo was alive, and then he's right, but you know, we don't know what the aftermath of this is. At least I don't, because I haven't seen the animated version of the next episode of this. But you almost kind of got to wonder, is would Echo have been better off not having survived on Citadel that right. rather than end up this way? And but you know, Rex believed in Echo's survival so thoroughly, and he's got it confirmed. But wow, I don't. He was not expecting this for Echo, and that's got to be a punch to the gut for him.
Oh yeah, well that screenshot that you have even in our notes here, just the look on Rex's face when he's looking at Echo, he's just you can tell that he's heartbroken for him, and just you know disgusted by what did they do to you. And oh, it's just, but it again, and I haven't seen the next part of this either, but I almost wonder if removing him from this is going to almost be worse for him. You know what I mean? In terms of the fact that he's being barely kept alive now by all of these cords and everything, how are they going to get him back?
Right. The other thing about this episode is that it makes me really appreciate when we see Rex in Rebels and how he's caring for his brothers there and why it meant so much more. Just that, because, you know, they are all suffering from some version of PTSD, and you see a scene like this where one of his brothers, especially one he cared about so deeply, ended up in such a bad state, why he would take it upon himself to go that extra mile to look after some of these guys. So this was good. You know, the more I liked it, again, probably not quite as much as you, but I'm liking it even more the more we've been talking about it, when we really consider the ramifications of what this episode meant.
Right, because there's so much subtext to it. And I think that that's what makes me love it so much, is that, like you said, in the three acts of this episode alone, there's so much depth. I mean, if you really watch for it and you really think about it, I mean, there's so much implication and there's so much richness there.
We've come to the end of the episode. Before we go on this one, did you have any final thoughts, and did you want to go ahead and give it a grade?
Well, I cannot let this go by without making another observation, as we were talking about Anakin and Obi-Wan and Padme. And again, just what we were just talking about with adding more richness and adding more depth and more understanding. And as you were talking about with what did Obi-Wan really know? Part of that, you know, I just think about the scene in Revenge of the Sith when Obi-Wan looks at Padme and says, "Anakin is the father, isn't he?" You know, he knew it. I mean, you know, he knew it all along. And we knew he suspected it even in Revenge of the Sith and even back in Attack of the Clones and everything else, too. So that right there just has so much more meaning to me now, that scene in Revenge of the Sith. Also with that as well is I just can't help but to think, well, okay, Mr. Filoni, why don't you know, you got George Lucas on speed dial. Why don't you ask him if he thought that Obi-Wan would think that Anakin would marry her and go that far? You know, like, why wouldn't you just call, hey, George, well, what do you think of this? I know, horrible Dave Filoni. Sorry if you're listening, Dave, that was awful. But you know what I mean? I don't know.
Well, I suppose. I mean, for me, I kind of respected him for not making that phone call. And for...
sure.
for creating an interpretation or something that, at least if you didn't do the Clone Wars download, you'd have some of the ambiguity here. And I really like the fact that I have, as I said earlier, I view Obi-Wan as being a little bit hurt by being left out of this, and you know, Anakin deliberately putting Rex between them to prevent him from getting into the barracks. And you know, and it's easy to see both sides of this. I could see Anakin saying, you know, Obi-Wan is my big brother and he's going to disapprove of me having this attachment, and therefore I just don't want him walking in and knowing. And because that look that Anakin throws back at Obi-Wan after Anakin says that, you know, well, did you at least tell, you know, Padme that I said hello? You know, and, you know, Anakin looks back and it's just kind of a, I think Anakin kind of felt bad for having to do that to Obi-Wan in a way. And that scene, it was just so beautifully crafted. I really think it added so much to the relationship and makes something like the end of the Revenge of the Sith, where, you know, Obi-Wan is just heartbroken about having to do what he did to Anakin, and he's pointing out, you are my brother. And you know, every time I do say that, I think of James Arnold Taylor when he told he did that imitation for us. But, you know, just that reaction, how much more painful it was because those two had been through so much for so long, and for it to come to that, and, you know, those kind of brother jealousy type things that come up. So I'm going to assume, based on what you said, that this episode, you know, how highly thought of it, that this was an A-plus episode for you.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Spoiler alert, definitely.
Yeah.
For sure. And for all those reasons and more. And, you know, and again, I've said it a bazillion times that these episodes of the Clone Wars, all of the Clone Wars series, you know, from season one on, really do lend so much more, especially to Anakin, because you understand and you empathize with him more, and his fall to the dark side means so much more than I think just the movies alone. So the animation in this was absolutely gorgeous in this particular episode. And, you know, again, like you were saying, just the facial expressions, and when Anakin was grabbed by that dragon or pterodactyl-like thing, flying dragon, you could see it on his face. And for, again, for an animated series to be able to lend that much is just incredible. And I, yes, A plus plus plus, absolutely loved it. Can't wait for the next episode.
Yeah. For me, this was an A minus. I actually liked the last episode a little bit better than this one. Mm-hmm. And for just a couple of reasons. One, I didn't feel like the middle act was really necessary for this episode. They could have landed on Skako Minor and then just found the base. There wasn't a real need other than just kind of maybe show off some of the capabilities of the Bad Batch for them to interact with the Poltex the way they did here. But that being said, it was a cool scene. It's just that, again, it was a bit superfluous. So, and then third, in the final act, there was never any doubt that we were going to see Echo in my mind on this. And but it does get rescued by the fact that the condition we see Echo in was so surprising. So,
right.
But you know, so it was just kind of a, it was an anticlimactic conclusion because we knew that they were going to find him. The surprise really came from the fact that he was in the condition he was, but good episode. I really enjoyed it. I am so glad that we've got the Clone Wars back, and it's better than ever with its visuals, the way that they're filming it and creating it, you know, improved textures. You know, Anakin looks much more like Hayden Christensen in the way he appeared in Revenge of the Sith than ever.
Yes.
This season, I should say. So kudos to them. They've done some great work. All right, then. Well, we've reached the end of episode 70 of Podcast Artists. We'd like to thank you all for listening to our discussion of A Distant Echo. We'd like to also remind you that you can find all episodes of Podcast Artists on RetroZap, Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Overcast, or wherever else it is that you listen to your podcasts. And of course, we are part of the RetroZap Podcast Network. And if you subscribe to the network feed, you'll get all the great RetroZap shows in one convenient place. If you've got 30 seconds on your hands, we would appreciate it if you'd spend them leaving us a 5-star review over on Apple Podcasts. That is one of the best ways you can help give back to the show and help the show grow. Those type of reviews do help Star Wars fans that are looking for a new Star Wars podcast in an otherwise crowded market notice us and give us a shot. With all that being said, Jay, can you remind everyone what our social media contacts are and where we can be found around the internet?
Sure. We can be found on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Artist. If you want to reach out to Dennis on Twitter, he is at DJKVER2, and I am at Joyce Krebs. You can also check out our Pinterest pages. We have a YouTube channel, and you can email us your thoughts at podcaststardust@retrozap.com. What did you think of this episode of The Clone Wars? We'd love to hear your thoughts, and we'll definitely read those on air. You can also catch us over on Discord. We have our own room on the Discord server, as well as all the other amazing RetroZap podcasts and some other dedicated chat rooms to things like The Clone Wars, spoiler alerts, you know, kinds of things. We still even have the Mandalorian discussion going on over there as well, if you want to join us there. And TeePublic is our store for all of our great merchandise that was designed for us and our show logos by Corey Club from Coffee with Kenobi. And I know they have sales every once in a while and again. And so if you need anything to outfit yourself, your house, your home office, your laptop, your computer, anything in general, just head on over there. We are tpublic.com/user/podcaststardust.
And of course, links will be in the notes. So until next time, thanks for listening, everyone, and may the force be with you.